read it.
Okay, Commissioner Mullins.
Aye.
Mr. Gallagher.
Here.
Mr. Brooks.
Here.
Okay, present.
Okay, stand as you wish for the place and the occasion.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Heavenly Father, we ask your presence at this meeting as we do the business of the county. We ask that you be with us individually and collectively. Help us make this a better county. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The consent agenda. There's the minutes of the meeting of January 29. We did not have a meeting last week. And treasurer monthly report. Okay, a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. The request for sealed bids, the IT department is going to, go ahead, Dan.
Last month, we were tasked maybe to look into getting a recording audio device for here in the commission room. I reached out to one local company, and I got a quote back. It was over our $6,000 threshold, so I stopped that process, and I'm just requesting if we want to continue this process, and we ask for sealed bids for some other vendors for the recording device for here in the commission room.
Where would that money come out of? We have a budget for, it's a miscellaneous account in the general fund. It's for when several departments are affected. And to, just to back up information, state law requires that any time an expenditure reaches or nears $6,000, we must get sealed bids on the process. So that's what we're requesting that we do since it did approach $6,000. And so do I have a motion?
That we permit the solicitation bids for sound and video at this
audio at this time, but it should have video capability in the future if we so desire. So,
second. Any questions? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Aye.
Now we have another sealed bid request. I don't see the main department in here, but okay, we need to do an elevator upgrade in the courthouse. System's old. We had a situation, was it last year, when lightning ran in and burned out the motherboard, and it took a month, I guess, to get a replacement. We lose ADA compliance when our elevator's down over there, and that really backs up the courthouse and situations over there. So it's time to upgrade that elevator, and that will be a sealed bid threshold, too. It's going to be more than $6,000. So do I have a motion?
Yes. Discussion.
Do I have a motion?
I don't have an issue with it. I would like to move that we allow bidding for an elevator in the St. Francis County Courthouse.
Elevator upgrade.
And I'd second the motion.
Yeah, comment?
We were looking at windows for this year, but unfortunately, you take what's needed first. And there are no grant opportunities right now at this time for Missouri DNR concerning elevators, but hopefully following year, they'll offer a courthouse round 7 for that grant cycle. I'm staying in tune with that, but right now there's no money available for that, so we'll keep that. But I would move it an elevator upgrade is much needed.
Yeah, the windows are drafty and expensive because of the heat loss and cooling loss. But this is a safety issue, an ADA issue. This is expressing. Okay, any other comments or questions? Okay, I have a motion, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Charles Gamble is going to talk to us.
First on the program, huh?
You're there.
I'm representing Farm Bureau, and we're asking that the county be proclaimed Thank the Farmer Week. And that is just a news release that's going to go in. And I wanted to ask how many of you, when you think of agriculture, what do you think of? When you think of agriculture, what do you think of?
Farms.
I drive by a lot of cow-calf operation hay farms.
Okay.
And some grain farms.
Same thing. And you do too.
I do too. That's right. I've got 20
perfect counts, and I'm proud of those guys.
Yeah.
That is something that I agree that we think of. We always think of something related to food most of the time, probably too. And I don't think any one of us got up this morning hungry, did we? No. Well, each farmer produces food for about 169 people, to give you an idea of what that turns out to be. And we always hear that food's too high, too expensive. We eat for less than 10% of our disposable income, and which is the lowest in the world. And so we think that there's real good reasons to thank the farmer every once in a while. And if we look at it from another perspective, what it adds to the economy is unbelievable. You don't think about St. Francis County as being a really big, major agricultural situation. But if you look at the data, about 1,450 jobs related to agriculture. You look at about $150 million in sales. And out of that, $58 million is added value. $96 million is purchases. And so if you come down, we got $32 million in labor income.
Charles, that's for this county.
That's for this county. This county. So we think it's a good opportunity to kind of take a little break this week and say thanks to the farmers. Or thanks to agriculture, I guess, is what we should say.
We do appreciate that. And we have a proclamation letter that I would love to sign, but I need approval to do that.
I would believe that we use this opportunity to thank a farmer. Okay. The resolution is very important for us on that.
I'll second that motion.
And any questions?
I would like to say that, you know, last year, keep in mind that this commission passed agri-ready status for St. Francis County. Out of 114 counties, I think we were the 47th county to support agri-ready status. And basically, what that says in a nutshell is the St. Francis County will support the Farm Bureau and support farmers. And if in the future that we would pass any type of resolution or ordinance, that we would reach out to the Farm Bureau and bring them in the picture and sit down with them and try to work. So, and we've done that. And I'm proud of that. And we'll be getting signs up on major arteries in this county, Highway 8, 67, and 32. So they'll be going up many times.
Yeah. Harold, I just wanted to say, I always thought Charlie was outstanding in his field.
Moving right along. I have a motion second. All in favor of my son, the proclamation, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you, Charles.
Thank you.
We need a letter of commitment approval for our outside auditing firm that we have under, I guess, contract for about 3 years, right?
Yes, this will be the second or third year.
Third year. So we just need the commitment to continue that and go ahead with it.
We will welcome Mr. Jones and Company starting next week to this building.
Motion.
I move that we enter into a commitment letter with the Daniel Jones and Associates as part of our outside audit.
Second that. Any questions? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Aye. Holiday closings. We have a meeting here pretty quickly. Next Tuesday, there will not be a meeting. I'll talk about that in the next slide. Lincoln's birthday, and then the February 18th is the next Monday. After that, all the offices, I guess, county and state will be closed. So that's the holiday closings for this month. Now, next regular meeting will be February the 19th because of that holiday closing, and be here this time of the day. Other business, correspondence, anyone? Okay, public comments, Mr. Mike Barks.
Thank you. My name is Mike Barks. I've been a resident of St. Francis County for about 34 years, which to some of you is nothing. I've been here a whole lot longer. Seems like lately you all have been receiving a significant amount of input and opinions on how you do your job and about different things that go on around here. So this is not a big deal, but I felt I needed to say it, and my wife won't let me comment on her Facebook page for probably obvious reasons. With all the snow and the cold weather that we've had lately, the conditions of the roads and your road department getting out there and cleaning them in a timely manner and making them drivable for us, I appreciate the heck out of that and think they've done a heck of a job. Thank you very well, whoever it is. Thank you, fellas. Appreciate it.
He has a crew that's out there, and we appreciate your comment. Thank you. It's a blessing to hear those things every day. We appreciate it. Any other public comments? Okay, departmental reports.
This gentleman here had his hand up.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes. I'm sorry.
I'm just curious on the Little St. Francis low water bridge on Tillman Road.
Yeah.
What's the status of it?
Right.
Well, it's not on the schedule to be replaced this year, but we want to completely replace that bridge probably in 2020. We're just going to keep dressing it up, fixing it as we need until then. But it's not on this year's schedule or budget to do, but it is more than likely we'll be taken care of in 2020.
And it washes out when the water gets across.
Right, and as soon as the weather will break, and we dress that up with rock, and I know it washes out every time. As soon as the weather warms up, we are going to tear that out and pour some concrete just to get us through temporarily so it won't wash out on the edges. I'd say March or so, as soon as it's warm enough for us to pour concrete, we'll do that. Because we can put asphalt down, the water just gets under it, just peels it up, washes away every time. But it is on the list for 2020 to be completely removed and replaced.
And that'll be a box culvert bridge.
Yes, yes.
I think you'll like that bridge.
I don't want you to think that it's not a priority. It is, but comparison to other bridges that we're going to replace this year, it's not a dead end, and it's really not super far to go around either way. That's one of the things that we take into consideration when we replace bridges is the amount of go around time that you have. That one's not extremely a long distance to go around either way, but we do have it on the list to replace.
It is if you're hauling hay.
Well,
we have another bridge that we're in danger of losing school bus ability, and it's a long go around, so we've got to move that one up in priority. So, any other?
But if there's ever any problems with those approaches, call us anytime and we'll dress them up and fix them right then, and we'll try to get that taken care of before spring.
And we still got our steel plate on that bridge?
On Buck Mountain, yes.
No, I mean, he had one of his bridges, you know.
No.
That's a little water crossing. I know, but I suck at his steel plate.
So you're probably thinking the Thomas Road Bridge is very similar to that one. We did have a steel plate on
Thomas. Okay, thank you. Any other public comments? Departmental reports? Let me talk about that. We have to go to Columbia, required. We have to be there the rest of this week for this. That's a County Commissioner Association of Missouri, and it is a big deal. It's an annual thing. Now, any other public comments?
Yeah, just a couple things here. The things that you asked about, I'm trying to do a couple a week. On the voter rolls, they did analysis, the ladies in our department, elections, we have 70% of the population over 18 that are active voters. We have 40,600 that are active and inactive. The problem is that we're going to try to look into, and this is fairly normal, but we have almost 4,600 inactive voters. We've sent them things, they won't respond, they haven't voted. And so we're looking for best practices in other counties on how to clean those up, because those are your potential, if you have any voter problems, those would be the group that you would have the the props, because they're inactive voters, they're on the rolls, they can vote, but yet a lot of them don't live where they say they did or did years ago. So that's what we're doing in that area. The couple things at the end of the year, we do all the licensing. And just a couple notes. One, the liquor license. And I talked to the auditor about this, and he was aware of it. We have no penalty if they're late, so there is no incentive for them. We had somebody come in December and pay their last year's liquor license bill. We really need to look at that, because there's, when they have no penalty, they don't care. The state has 100% penalty when they don't get theirs, plus a fee to actually do the paperwork. So just a thought there. The other thing is, we had 16 new homes this year, building permits. Not all new homes, but building permits. That's very low. And I said, what's the action if they don't get one? And there is none. So the people that come get a building permit to let our assessors know that there's new, just doing it out of the kindness of their heart, because there is no hammer there at all, or incentive to, even if they don't get caught, there's nothing. So that's something that you all may want to address.
I think that was started in 1982, because the house I was building at that time, I was the first one to buy a building permit.
Isn't that nice?
Yeah,
we have water retention. The building I built had to be the first one that I had to take and have water retention. Sometimes it falls that way. One other thing, we have we've been looking at other counties where they pay their poll workers. We are currently paying our poll workers a little over $7 an hour, and that has not changed in years. I'm going to be coming to you probably with a request that we pay them $10 an hour. They work 14-hour days, and I'm not saying that we legally have to pay the minimum wage, but we probably, if we're demanding of all of our businesses, we ought to at least look at it that way. Then the supervisors, you have a Republican, a Democrat supervisor in every precinct. They typically get, in the past, 20% more. We used to pay a phone fee to have a cell phone. We're not going to do that anymore. If they don't have a cell phone, they probably are out of touch with reality, and so they may not be the best one to supervise there. So we are probably recommended by 20%, like $10, $12. And then we talked about this. We used to have a full-time person and then a part-time person that would prepare the ballots. I'd like the balloting places and do the work that week while we were doing absentee ballots in the office. I've asked Mark Hedrick to consider that that position. I've asked Charlotte Boyer, a longtime county office holder. They're very aware, and the thought would be is that we'd have a supervisor in the north part of the county, one in the center, and one in the south, that whatever would, because the questions we have now on IDs and should you vote a provisional ballot and those type things, someone could be there that had that authority to look at that and say, yes, this is okay, or this is the process, or any of this. The poll supervisors have a question that they can get there within a matter of minutes if we have somebody in all three of those locations. So we would like to then pay them commensurate around 15 to 18, depending on where the level of strength is there. I will come to you with it, but I wanted to give you an idea. That's what we're thinking. If you guys don't think we should do it, but we've got a training session next month, and I'd like to clear that up to be able to, because we're fortunate that we have poll workers. A lot of them, I saw an ad in the paper for St. Louis today, because trying to find poll workers for the March election. And we've got a great group, but we probably ought to at least keep their pay up to where they're not overpaid, but they're at least above that point.
Kevin, do you know what is the current status for non-citizens voting in the state of Missouri?
That's in court right now, but along with that, I don't know where it's right now. Our take is that they are not allowed to vote, but that's what's in court. Okay.
Going back to what you said about the inspections, are, was builder's permits?
Yes.
For residential property in the county? How is that going to track if you're thinking about how to deal with that, maybe enforcing permit requirements and things like that? How's that going to track with, say, the state requirement for inspections of, say, sewer lines for properties that are less than 3 acres?
Right. That's one of the main reasons given that you were supposed to have a permit. I'm not saying it will differ in any way, but that was one of the assessor's office and the county health get that report from our office. And what I'm saying is probably there was more than 16 constructions that took place last year, but since there is no hammer in it, all I want to do is make the commission aware that that's something they ought to probably look at. If they want more compliance, they're going to have to give the people a reason to comply, because the health department would like to know when a new home, so that they can inspect and see if it has to be an engineered system. If it's less than 3 acres, if it's a 2 acre system and it has to be engineered, they have to have that engineering approved. Or if it's over 3 acres, to do a standard septic system situation, the health department would like to inspect that. If you don't even know what houses are going in, then that's very difficult for them to do their job on the front side. And then what happens is the resident gets all ticked off when, after they put it in, they come back and say, that's not in compliance.
Okay, because I had understood the law to say that if your property is 3 acres or more, you don't even require an inspection by the health department. You don't have to go out and get a permit to put in your septic system and things like that. And I was wondering if you were talking about all properties in the county or just properties under 3 acres.
No, it's all properties in the counties, and the health department then is given that notice, and what they do with it, they'd have to make, I don't know what they're, I'm not saying
they're
there.
I think the statute specifically limits it to 3 acres, less than
right,
3 acres.
Right, it does that, but I don't know if the health department requires an inspection of that system.
I see.
I know when mine went in, they had inspected, but okay. I was at 2 acres, and mine had to have engineering, and I had to show that, and they had to come out.
Okay.
But that's what I'm saying. That's something for the future. Once again, I said, as I saw these things, I would make you aware of them, because that's something we probably ought to address in something like that. So that and the voters, and that's all I have today.
I have a question, yeah. Kevin. On the segment of voters that aren't identified or are missing or whatever that you were talking about, what happens to someone who's homeless, who once upon a time had voting privileges?
They still have those voting privileges, but they're at wherever they were currently registered.
Okay.
But those are, a lot of people are still active. They vote.
Okay.
4,585 people are eligible voters, but they're inactive. So, and to me, that would, if there's any problems, and I'm not saying that there is, because that's fairly well in line with other people, mm-hmm. but I'm going to look at other counties and say, how do they address these inactive?
Right.
You can't spend thousands and thousands to try to get them, but that's where the fuzzy is they're inactive,
mm-hmm.
they could activate themselves,
mm-hmm.
there could be multiple people at that house. It's been sold 3 times, and you have 3 sets of people that are registered there, and they're not there, and that's where your potential. So I know that there's other counties that are being proactive at those and saying, we need to get that number down to a very small amount, because there are people that just quit voting.
Right.
You know, and that's different than 3 different people with the same residence.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Do you have public comment? Okay. Before our next meeting on February 18th, we'll be giving the St. Francis County address, state of the county address. So that will be in Bonterre. So that's where that is. And welcome you all to it. It'll be at the Knights of Columbus, 8 a.m. that morning. Okay.